Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our next speaker, Mr. Sanjeev Parkar, Senior Director, Human Capital, PricewaterhouseCoopers.
I would request Dr. K.K. Veluri, sir, Director BITM, to welcome our guest with a bouquet.
Thank you, sir.
May we now call upon Shruti Singh, Student Manager, Balaji Institute of International Business, to introduce our guest.
A very good afternoon to one and all present here. I, Shruti Singh, Student Manager, Balaji Institute of International Business, feels honored in introducing amongst us Mr. Sanjeev Parkar, Senior Director, Human Capital, PricewaterhouseCoopers. Sir is associated with PwC since almost 8 years and has 20 years of experience in HR. During his career, Sir has worked with reputed organizations like AC Nelson, Future Group, Maersk, Century Rayon, and Webify Services. While working with these companies, Sir has done intense work in the area of leadership development, organizational development, and strategic HR. After graduating in chemistry, Sir completed his post-graduation in labor studies from Mumbai University. He also holds a degree in law. His current role with PwC encompasses national HR head for tax consulting business across India. It is a strategic business HR role and works very closely with CEO and other business leaders. Sir, we are highly privileged to have you here amongst us. Now, I would like you to enlighten us with your words of wisdom. Thank you.
So, formal good afternoon, everyone. So, I don't know what to say.
Hello.
Just make sure that your mobile phone doesn't.
Hello.
So good afternoon once again, and including backbenchers. Good afternoon. Better. So nothing worse can happen to you, right? It's already afternoon, and just to set the right tone for the presentation. So what I'm going to present is, so my index of my presentation matches the summary of my last speaker. So it's exactly almost the same. Okay, so don't get bored. Some of you, if you start yawning, I'll not be surprised, because you'll see a lot of contents which are like similar, and I'm sure when you'll have a question and answer series, the first question is going to be like, so although I'll talk about a lot of strategic stuff around economics and people issues and all that, because I'm from HR, but I know what's going to be the first question. The first question is that, sir, do you know what acute hunger is? Okay, or possibly, have you seen people dying of hunger? So I can relate to, and the feelings are mutual, let me tell you this. I also did not have lunch. So I'll try to keep it as light as possible. And you know, the presentation is the same as I explained to you. Possibly context will be different. So, and let's make it as interactive as possible. I try to make it as light as possible, okay? So being in HR, I'm a storyteller, okay? And because that is the only way I can keep you awake, okay? How many of you have seen a movie called The Gods Must Be Crazy? Wow, quite a few, okay? The Gods Must Be Crazy. So there is this for, I think, you know, about 10% people have seen this, and it's not a spiritual movie, as you know that. It's a very hilarious movie, okay? The way it goes is, you know, so there is a Coca-Cola bottle that drops from an aircraft, and, you know, it just falls among the tribals, okay? It's shot on Africa, okay? So there is this gentleman, and, you know, that Coca-Cola bottle drops. People start making, they thought that, you know, it's sent by God, okay? And they start making the best use of that bottle. You know, they start rolling rotis. They start, you know, use this as a musical instrument and so on and so forth. Okay? Then there are fights. There is a resource crunch. People start fighting with each other. And they believe that there is something wrong with that bottle. They feel that this is something sent by evil. Okay? So the entire movie about this gentleman, whatever, he picks up the bottle. He said, I will throw this at the end of the world. Where the world ends, I'm going to throw this out. So that evil is gone. Okay? Entire movie is around that. So my entire presentation is something like that. Okay? We'll try to find out whether such bottle exists. Okay? Is there something that is sent by evil? Is there a place where we can throw this bottle outside the world, etc.? That's what we're going to do. Okay? And in between, you can stop me if you have any questions. Okay, this is not very different from what earlier person would have spoken to you about. What I'm going to talk about are 3-4 things. One is, we're going to talk about megatrends. Okay? How many of you heard about megatrends? Megatrends? Global megatrends? Nobody. So I'm safe. Then, how these megatrends impact businesses in India? What is happening with people mindset? You know, are we going to have a different set of people issues? About millennials, I think enough has been spoken to you about millennials. So I would not like to bore you again with that. Okay? Then, what do you mean by dynamic business? What is changing? And the skills you will require. So as the world is changing, do you require any special skills? Do you need to acquire new special skills, etc.? That's what I'm going to talk about. Looks good? Looks good?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Okay. Hopefully, the last row is able to read this, if they're awake. Are you guys there?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So I'm from PwC. I work with an organization called PricewaterhouseCoopers. So we did, you know, among different researches, there's one research that we did on megatrends. How world is getting impacted. And there are 3-4 things that, you know, that we came up with. So, demographic and social change. Shift in global economic power, rapid urbanization, climate change, and technological breakthrough. I was attending the presentation that Avijit made. I'm sure he has covered quite a bit. Okay, but I'll just cursorily go through, you know, some slides. And if you've got any questions, you can always ask me the questions. Okay. So what are these mega trends? As you know, world is changing. Everyone knows about it. It's like that Coca-Cola bottle. We just want to know what it is. What is going to change the look and feel of the world? Okay, what is impacted? You all are going to be the future leaders. Unless you know what is changing, you'll not be able to influence that. Okay, so let me go to the first slide about demographic shifts. Okay, so if you look at global middle class, you know, if you look at 2009 data, okay. Look at the shift that is happening. Asia Pacific was about 21 trillion. In 2030, it is expected that, you know, it will be about 55 trillion. And these are all through reliable sources, okay? Look at the population growth rate. Now, just something about population. So in my school days, I used to learn about the issues or challenges because of the increase in population. The same thing that was challenged once upon a time okay, is becoming an advantage for us now. So we are no longer talking about issues coming out of population increase. What are we talking about is, how do we utilize them? What are the skills that they should acquire and make this a better place? Okay? Just look at this column. The world population, which is aged 60 years or more, 1950 it was about 8%, 2000 is 10%. Now 2050 is going to become almost 21%. So some of you must be trying to count these people and add up as, you know, 21, etc. That will not happen. Okay, this is a pictorial presentation. Okay, so from 8% it's going to 21%. That's a big shift, demographic shift that is happening. Now, if you look at GDP, okay, if you look at G7 countries, I'm sure some of you would have read about it. You have got G7 countries like US, Japan, Germany, UK and all, okay? And then you got E7 countries, which is China, India, Brazil, Russia, Indonesia, Mexico and Turkey. If you look at 2009, look at the GDP, it's 29 and it is 20 trillion. If you look at 2050, and this is another forecast that we got, in 2050, it will be roughly about, G7 will be 69 trillion. And E7 is about 138 trillion. It's a huge, huge shift. Okay? World is moving from west to east. Everyone knows about it. That's a big shift that is happening. And we're coping up with those challenges. Thirdly, about urbanization. In 2010, look at the urban population, you know. From 2010, which is 3.8 billion, it is going to 4.9 billion in 2030. Okay, and urbanization has its own set of challenges, advantages. Okay, look at world urban population. So, you know, if you look at all this data, if you see urbanization that's happening in a big way, you need to have differently skilled people to handle this. Then, you know, infrastructure has improved. Okay, globally, urbanization has been taken at very serious level, okay? And this is obviously impacting not only other countries, but it is impacting India as well. Climate change, I think Avijit has already spoken to you about. Now, if you look at things like, you know, water scarcity. So here, you know, you've got something called physical water scarcity. Now, if you look at countries here, these are all countries where there'll be physical water scarcity in 2025, physical water scarcity. This particular, you know, buff color, countries, there will be economic water scarcity. This means physically water scarcity will not be there, but obviously, you know, there will not be infrastructure to get water out of it. So, you know, this is about economic water scarcity. And other countries are very little, no water scarcity, and, you know, others are not estimated. So, if you look at natural resources are depleting, okay, including India. And in 2030, look at, I think you are not able to see this, I think there is some problem with the font. Okay. So we require in 2030, we require 50% more energy, 40% more water, okay, and 35% more food. That's going to be the forecast. Finally, technological breakthrough. Is there anyone in this group who doesn't have WhatsApp? Nobody, okay? So when I talk about social media, I think everyone is going to be there, okay? The look and feel is changing. Everything is on cloud, okay? And then we've got something called the Internet of Things, which is anything that can get connected will get connected, okay? So we are becoming smaller world now, okay? So if you look at industry also, today we are moving from an era of paper paperless, okay? Everything is going on cloud, but the format is changing, okay? So this is about technological breakthroughs. So all the things are changing. And somebody, Avijit spoke to us about Uberization, okay? What is Uberization? That is something that he talked about. But in everything depend on technology. Then you know, you've got connected devices. So So today people are more connected to devices than each other. Okay, that's a big change that is happening. Okay, so these are the 4-5 mega trends that we see. Let me pause here. Okay, any questions till now? I assure you that you know your lunch will not get prolonged. So be safe. Any questions? No questions? Do you require amnesty from the professors that you can ask questions? No, okay. So what is the effect of megatrends on businesses in India? Number one is, you know, mega cities, mega corridors. There are a lot of smart cities that are coming up. You would have seen in Prime Minister's agenda, you know, you got a lot of smart cities coming up, smart corridors are coming up, mega corridors are coming up. You got Naya Raipur and things like that. Innovating to zero, we are working on reducing the emission to zero. Connectivity and convergence, we are connecting, okay? We have got internet rapidly growing. You got devices that are getting connected. We got everything on mobile, okay? Today, there was a time when I used to print out increment letters, we don't. Okay, today everyone is giving feedback on mobile phone. Okay, people are getting connected everywhere. Okay, bricks and clicks. Then we have got future of energy and resources. Sustainability is a big thing. And when I was taking this round of campus, I was pleasantly surprised that, you know, you guys are working on rainwater harvesting and stuff like that, reverse osmosis. It's a good start, and I think, you know, kudos to the team who's making that happen. Okay. Urbanization is happening in India also. New cities are coming up. We are no longer again going to metros again and again. Finally, well-being, wellness, that's again in thing. All your hospitals, all your healthcare facilities, insurances, everything is getting connected. So all those things are happening in India. Okay. So mega trends, what is happening globally, is also getting connected to India. Now this is where I would like to spend a little more time. You would have heard about gender diversity. So there is an expectation that, you know, when we'll have more and more female women network coming in employment, GDP, there'll be a boost of 27% in India by 2020. So let me talk about PwC as an organization. And obviously, there are many other consulting firms who do that. We take pride in saying that, you know, we have diversity of workforce. Now, diversity in workforce is not exactly about gender diversity. It is about ethnic diversity. It is about having differently abled people, people who come from different origins, people who come from different geographies. I think that makes us a very diverse organization, okay? So in terms of gender diversity, you know, if you look at bottom of the pyramid, in bottom of the pyramid, you've got 50% men and 50% women ratio. But as pyramid goes up, you know, at senior level, you'll have ratio disturbed. You've got more men, less women, okay? So while it's a good idea to talk about diversity, we need to create an ecosystem. We need to create an ecosystem to ensure that, you know, more and more women are inducted, they continue with us. So, you know, we came up with things like flexibility. Now, flexibility is not only about part-time working, you know. So, it talks about having alternate career for women, okay? Because that is where things are going to change. If they have family commitment, okay, can we give them sabbatical? Can you bring them back to the floor? Because, you know, anyways, in consulting, talent sources are limited, okay? So how do you make the best use of it? Then we've got something called as, you know, a communication campaign around subconscious or unconscious bias, okay? So when I'm interviewing people, there may be a possibility that I may be thinking that, you know, listen, you know, if I hire this lady, you know, she will have family commitment, you know, she will get married, so your children, and then, you know, my work will get disrupted. So that these are all blind spots. How do you remove these blind spots? Okay, Can we educate people? Because it's a question of education. So as a firm, there are a lot of firms who have taken this initiative that, you know, we would have enough gender diversity so that all of us are not thinking in the same manner. So, okay. So to promote that, we have come up with a lot of newer policies. Okay. So you would have seen that, you know, now Maternity Benefit Act has changed. So it's relaxed. Okay. So we are one of those, you know, leading companies where, you know, we did more than what is expected from statutory. Okay. Secondly, we have got something called Women's Network. We give external mentors to women. Okay, that is to ensure that, you know, more and more talents are inducted into the system. Okay. So I met a lady who handles your the magazine where, you know, you've got a lot of, it's called some citizen, what is it called? Corporate Citizen, okay. So she asked me a question and that actually made me think. She was asking me a question around talent, okay. So Abhijit spoke about, you know, VUCA, whatever. So there's a lot of uncertainty, okay. The question is, if you look at the talent today, when we go for campuses today, all the people will talk about similar things, you know. People will talk about having, you know, best of the infrastructure. People will talk about having a great learning experience, training and development. Everyone talks about the same thing. So how do we get the talent inducted into our system? Because, you know, if you look at career, so likewise, when I look at this room, all the people look alike to me, okay? So similarly, in your campuses, where do you look at the corporates? All the corporates will look alike to you, okay? You'll say, you know, this firm gives trainings, others are also giving. This firm sends you on secondment, others are also doing. So we are not here to sell jobs. We do not sell jobs, number one. What we sell is career. What is going to happen for 15 years from now, okay? So we have got every person in this room is millennial. The question that people ask me is, after 15 years is okay. What about today? Okay? Can you answer that to me? Okay, the answer to that is, today world has become uncertain. Okay? Whatever career that you have today may not be, you know, there after 15 years. Okay? So what we do is, we give them a roadmap. How industry is growing, how sector is growing. Okay? So suppose, you know, many of you are marketing professionals, some of you are HR professionals, some of you are finance professionals. So I think gone are the days of, you know, only functional skills. Today, function intersects with your sectors. The finance in telecom, okay, or marketing in telecom is so very different than marketing in FMCG, for instance, etc. Okay? So because sector is changing. Same goes for consulting, okay? So we sell those dreams to people and we actually make it happen. Okay, there's something which is a big thing when you are looking at the talent acquisition. Same goes for talent management. Okay, so when I talk to my son, okay, so I want my son to become a chartered accountant. I'm not necessarily telling you about Three Idiots story, okay, I'm not doing that. So when I talk to my son, I say, listen, you know, I think you chartered accountants is a good career for you because your aptitude tests say so, okay? But in his mind, he wants to become a football player, okay? So there is a huge contrast. So he is unable to register or my thoughts are not getting assimilated. The same thing is happening in the industry today, okay? So gone are the days when manager was saying that, you know, I will lay down a career path for you, okay? It's not going to happen, okay? Because your coachee or your appraisee or your junior would have a different career path in his mind, okay? So I have become manager after 5 years of experience, so I'm expecting my juniors also to happen, you know, to follow the career path, which may not be just so, okay? One. Secondly, every person is having customized career path, you know? Today, you know, if somebody joins consulting, I expect that person to become partner after 14 years. So I'm having conversation with the gentleman and say that, listen, you know, this is how you'll become a partner in so many years. But he says that, you know, I don't want to become a partner of your firm. I may want to pursue a different dream altogether. So if you look at talent retention, it has got so many new connotations now, okay? Career path is not driven by managers any longer. Career path will be decided by each one of you for yourself. Okay, that is the way it works. Innovation at work. I think enough has been spoken on this subject. We spoke a lot about project development. We spoke a lot about product development. But innovation is the in thing. Okay? Innovation not only within India, but at a global level also, you know. What are your contributions? And every organization today is promoting only one issue, which is innovation. Can you innovate? Can you make it better? Can you innovate your product, you know? And lastly, conflict management. So in any organization today, you'll have 10% people who are Generation X. There are 20% people who are Generation Y. There are millennials, lot of millennials. So in the same bag, you know, you've got three categories of people. So you will see a lot of conflicts, okay? So today, a typical manager or a typical HR person spends a lot of time to, you know, resolve this conflict issue because, you know, the junior is not able to talk to senior, senior is not able to coach him, and so on and so forth. It is happening so because of the generation gap, okay? What was there in my home has become a feature in the office, okay? So how do we resolve that? And that conflict management is taking a lot of our time, and not only for us HR people, but also for the managers and the seniors, okay? So a whole lot of new issues that are arisen, okay? So therefore, you know, when, and this is another question that a student asked me today, what do you expect out of a, you know, fresher or a professional nowadays, okay? So what do I expect? So firstly, let me talk about networking. And networking is not about your IT networking. It is about your ability to connect to people, learn from others, okay? So typically, you know, a lot of marketing people are here. So they say, you know, so when we talk about networking, they say, you are expecting us to talk to the CEOs, but we wouldn't know CEOs. How do we network with people? Okay, today we have got social networking available, okay? But what is important is your ability to go out of your, you know, cubicle, meet people, understand their needs, and nurture those relationships, okay? It so happens, let me give you an example to make my point. So if you're a marketing professional, you're talking to a client, the level at which you're talking to client, that person may be very junior person. As you start growing up, that person also grows up. So after 10 years, okay, you'll be at a senior level, he'll also be at a senior level, he or she will be at a senior level. So that relationship that you have created now, will give you benefits after 10 years. Okay, so it's not about short-term benefits, okay? I think what is important is, you should start developing that art of networking, be well-read. Again, this is one question we ask in the interviews. You know, when we interview people, we say that, you know, what do you read? Okay? So typically answer is Economic Times. Okay? So we tell people, I said, you know, why are you not reading business magazines? Okay, why are you not keeping yourself updated with what is happening around? Macroeconomics, all of that. I think that plays a big role. And why it plays a big role is, when you are talking to clients or your internal stakeholders, it will be never about your function. Okay? It will be about a lot of other things that are not related to your work. Okay? And that will help you a lot. Business intelligence. Okay? In addition to your business, what are the other businesses that you know of? You know, typically people are quite internal focused. You know, people talk about processes, procedures, how we can make things better in our overall organization. So that those days are gone. Now you need to be a external focus. What is that your competition is doing? Okay, and you would have seen enough number of examples in the history of, you know, it could be telecom, hardware, software, and all that. organization started well and then they lost the plot. Okay? It has happened. It has happened because business intelligence was not there. Okay? Innovation was not there. So we'll expect people to have that business intelligence. Global acumen. We spoke a lot about mega trends. Okay? How those mega trends are impacting your business. Nobody wants to know today, if you are in consulting, your client doesn't want to know what has happened in the past. Okay? He or she wants to know what is going to happen after 5 years, 10 years. And that you should be able to do only when you have got that global acumen, when you have got grip over what is happening around the globe. Technical capabilities. Each one of us is supposed to be a technically competent person. Okay? Now this is another grouse that you know clients have from consulting. When I as a consultant, when I meet the client, okay, I do not try to understand what client needs. I tell him what I know. Okay? I try to tell him that listen, you know, I know this much. Okay? Am I trying to understand client's requirement? Have I asked him, how are you doing? Okay? What are your challenges? Okay? So that was a doctor-patient relationship. You know, you'll ask client, how are you doing? So this is just one basic stage. If you really want to, you know, succeed in consulting, the way you should do it is when you meet a client, you should do homework. You sense the problems that client may have. And then you go with some 4 solutions, out of which he picks up 1. Okay? So gone are the days where you know you say that you know client will tell you what the problem is. You need to identify the problem and go with the solution. Finally, leadership. As I said, all of you look identical to us. Okay? What differentiate one best professional from others is your leadership. The way you communicate. Are you agile? Are you making sense to people? Okay? Do you have vision? Okay? Do you have the speed? Do you have that ability to innovate? Do you have ability to lead? Now, leadership doesn't start when you become senior. Leadership starts from your day one. Okay? So these are some of the things that you know you will look at. Some competences, collaborative, confidence, innovation, personal responsibility, integrity, promptness, making a difference. Now here is a line that touched my life. Road to success is always under construction. The journey of 1,000 miles begins with just 1 step. It will be what we make of it. So if you guys are planning, if you guys are thinking that you know career path will be laid down by organization, impossibility. Okay, if it is there, nothing like it. If it matches you, your career path, nothing like it. It is for you to make the most out of it. Okay, it is for you to lay down your own career path and follow it. Organization provides you all sorts of supports. Okay, there are a lot of best practices you will learn. Okay, you need to invest that time. Okay, so there are a whole lot of new things that are happening in the industry. Learn that. You guys have a long future, and we spoke about a lot of things like, you know, mega trends, we spoke about the competencies, some of it already got covered, etc. So let me pause here, let me stop here, okay? At the cost of repetition, let me ask you this question, okay? Does it make sense to you from global mindset? Does it make sense from global mindset? Okay, so there is a very weak yes and there is a largely no saying that, you know, leave us. Allow us to go for lunch, okay? So, second thing that we can do is that, you know, if you have got any specific questions around consulting, you feel that, you know, you have any questions around what is going to happen the next, about the uncertainty, or mega trends, I'm more than willing to answer. Any questions?
Rashmi, is Rashmi. I'm from Operation Senior Staff. So my question is, what is your view on the much debated topic, paternity leave policy approval in an organization?
Whether we should or whether we should not?
Yes, sir. What's your opinion? We should have a paternity leave.
Yeah, you should have. I think, you know, again, this is more of a gender diversity. Now, typically, you know, there is one grouse that you'll always have is that, you know, men will also always feel that, you know, I'm not generalizing the statement. You know, I know there are, you know, some biases like that. So it is felt that all the policies today are revolving around women, you know. So your maternity policy and all of that, right? So what happens is this kind of, you know, creates a lot of drift in the organization. Okay? And what is maternity and paternity all about? Or, you know, these leaves are all about? Okay? We are trying to show, or we are showing, that we care. We care for your problem. We care for your issue. When you say flexibility, so any flexibility, any leave, okay, is always, you know, it's always drain on your revenue, right? It's a no-brainer, right? When you leave, obviously some money is gone, right? But we say we care. We understand that you have been working long hours here. You have different set of problems. So if you have maternity leave and we are extended, as I think there is a legislation that is passed to, you know, extend the maternity leave. But we say that we care. We care for people. You know, we want you to, you know, take care of your family. Same thing goes for paternity also. So if there are men, who have those requirements, why not?
My question is,
you're talking about the mega trends. So there is always a possibility that there will be a cycle or someone who can manage the making that trend, use that data.
Question answer, some lighter.
Okay, so let me repeat his question. It's a great question. His question is, you know, these mega trends, you know, there are instances where forecast has gone wrong, right? Forecast has gone wrong. So where is the guarantee that these mega trends will not go wrong? I can say that, you know, of any forecast for that matter, you know, is based on assumptions. It's based on the trends. It depends on the live data. Okay? This is just an extrapolation. So tomorrow, you know, all of a sudden there's some kind of disruption. You know, everything will change. Today, based on whatever trends that we are seeing and where we stand today, I think these are the fair assumptions. The way we are urbanizing it. Fair assumption that, you know, if there is so much of urbanization, this is what will happen. If there is an internet penetration like this at exponential rate, this is where we'll lead. The way water is being consumed, we know that this water will be, you know, useful in final time, etc. So it's a basically extrapolation. You never know. You know, all you know that this mega trend will be, you know, they can go for a toss. But this is after a lot of collaboration of data, a lot of thought that has gone into it. I feel that, you know, it's here to stay. Obviously, you know, this mega trend has come from one consulting and based on a lot of data sources. Okay. Some other consultancy company can come up with a different mega trend, but largely, you know, the pattern is the same. Firstly, do we disagree to this? Largely, to my mind, it looks very convincing. All these mega trends are looking very convincing. They're here to stay. Urbanization happening, women workforce is going up, wealth diversity, millennials are going to be there. Aging population is there, everything is there. I don't think it will go.
Hello, sir. My name is Smriti. I'm from MM Marketing. So I just wanted to ask that how do you deal with a firm who is selling products at a low cost? How do you deal with that kind of competition?
Okay. So this is only for my firm, or do you feel that we charge more?
No, sir, in general.
Okay. So basically, you know, I think there are people who travel by Indigo, there are people who travel by Kingfisher, there are people who travel in business class, and all of that, right? So it depends what the purpose of your firm and where do you want to position yourself. So, you know, there are some organizations, they sell only premium products. So they just want to sell. You know, for instance, so today Mercedes may not want to get into a commercial or, you know, hatchback segment. That's their positioning, right? So similarly, you know, if you look at a lot of organizations, they spend a lot of time in improving processes, okay? They have got cutting-edge technology and all that, but client doesn't pay. Okay? Do you anytime pay for inputs? Okay, for instance, you know, I'm just making it up, okay? Suppose Colgate puts up some state-of-the-art plant, you know, in Himachal Pradesh, etc. Would you pay higher, more money for Colgate to the answer? No. When will you pay more money? When you are delighted with that product or services. So we do not necessarily cut down on our, cut down on our positioning. Okay, and there are a lot of firms who do that. They say that we are only in that segment. We are in the boutique segment. We are not in a commercial segment. So we have no argument about people who charge less. Okay, because we are in a different segment, and we continue to be in that segment.
Hello, sir. So this is Bhagesh Kupadia for MJS Finance. So I want to ask that government is intent of foreign and audit firms, financial consultancy firms to register and operate directly in Indian market to liberalize the service sector. So sir, how will it benefit our economy?
I couldn't hear your question.
Yes, sir.
The
government is intending to allow foreign audit and consultancy firms to register and operate directly in India market to liberalize the service sector. So, sir, how will it benefit our economy?
Okay. So, that's a tough one. Because whatever I say will be held against me, right? Okay. So, I think it's going to benefit us. Okay. Any new entrants. Okay, any new entrant, it always helps us. Okay? Because we are positioning ourselves not only as, you know, domestic service providers, there are a lot of law firms that you will see. Okay? A lot of new audit firms that you will see, etc. And government has deregulated some of their, you know, businesses, etc. So I think, you know, it will only benefit clients when you got more and more services providers like this coming in. Obviously there will be some regulatory challenges. I'm saying that, you know, it's not going to be so simple. Okay? As we have more and more people coming here and government is, you know, opening up the market, that's going to benefit the clients at large.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.
Thank you, sir.
Request Dr. Suresh Chandrapadi, Director of BIIB, to present a memento to our guest.
Thank you.